starts in 5 minutes.
The winner of American Idol 2002 is... Kelly Clarkson.
Don't ever let somebody tell you you can't do something. Not even me. All right?
All right.
You got a dream, you got to protect it.
And so, my fellow Americans, ask not what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country.
I'm going to step off the limb. That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
Show starts in 4 minutes.
Dick Van Dyke Show, starring Dick Van Dyke, Rosemary, Maury Amsterdam, Larry Matthews, and Mary Tyler Moore.
I want to thank my agents. I want to thank Rick Kurtzman. I want to thank Kim Hodgett. I want to thank Steve Smoot. I want to thank my managers, Jamie King and Marcus King. Let's live this African-American dream. It's beautiful. I'm glad I'm with you, and I ain't never leaving you, so I love you.
Show starts in 3 minutes.
So even though we face the difficulties of today and tomorrow, I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream.
One-fifth of America, over 32 million people, now live in the suburbs, and 1.25 million more are moving in each year.
I pulled up to the house about 7 or 8, and I yelled to the cabbie, "Yo, home, smell you later." Looked at my kingdom, I was finally there to sit on my throne as the Prince of Bel-Air.
Show starts in 2 minutes.
An iPod, a phone, and an internet communicator. Are you getting it? These are not three separate devices. This is one device. And we are calling it iPhone.
I want to do something big and something important.
You know, George, I feel that in a small way we are doing something important. It's satisfying a fundamental urge. It's deep in the race for a man to want his own roof and walls and fireplace. And we're helping him get those things in our shabby little office.
God bless America, land that I love.
Show starts in 1 minute.
Richard Nixon, that's my final answer.
Well, my gosh. What can I say except, Debbie, you're going to Paris, and this is the final answer heard all around the world. He's won $1 million.
Baseball, the great American game, the national pastime of millions, both young and old. The game is played with a sphere known as a baseball. The cork and rubber core is carefully wrapped with yarn and covered with tough horsehide.
The bat is made of carefully selected wood and perfectly balanced.
I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died.
It's a happy-go-spending world.
Father God, we thank you for the opportunity to hear from you. God, I pray that you would open up our ears to listen to your voice, God. We've not come to hear the words of men, but the words of the living God. We know that your word says that you are the rewarder of those who will diligently seek after you. So God, even right now, we position our hearts in a place of seeking, knowing that we will receive from you if we do. God, I pray that you open up each one of our eyes to be able to see things through your perspective. Allow your calling to settle on our lives. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Welcome to the American Dream. The American Dream is an ideal that is woven into the very fabric of our being. It's something that within our society and our culture is idolized, even to the point where it's become iconic. And every single university student that sets foot on a campus in America is chasing after the American Dream. Matter of fact, even as I've traveled across the world, I continue to find people in more countries that are actually chasing after the American Dreams, and they're not even Americans. I was no different as an 18-year-old college freshman at the University of Nebraska, trying to get an engineering degree. I was chasing after the American Dream. I wanted the life. I wanted to make the quote-unquote comfortable living. Get a degree, have a job that I loved, marry a woman that I loved, have 2.3 children. You guys know what I'm talking about? It's 2.1? Okay, I thought it was 2.3. Actually, at one point I did have 2.3 kids. We had two kids and my wife was 3 months pregnant and I was like, yes, we did it. The American Dream. It feels different than I thought it would. But the thing is, my American Dream didn't start when I was a freshman in college. It started a long time before that, with questions of what do you want to be when you grow up. It was reinforced by those games of MASH where you just hope you can get the mansion. I don't want to live in the shack, even if it is with her. No. But no matter where it started, it grew from that point. My question for you to start off with is, where did your American Dream begin?
What do you want to be when you grow up?
Play.
You want to be what?
I'm going to play.
You want to play? When you grow up, you just want to play?
I want to go so I can be a race car.
When I grow up, I want to be a firefighter and the famous singer. I want to be a doctor when I grow up.
I want to be a firefighter when I grow up.
I want to be a ninja.
I want to be a basketball player.
Why do you want to be a basketball player?
I want to be famous.
When I grow up, I want to be a penguin trainer.
Cool. Why do you want to be that?
Because they're cute.
When I grow up, I want to be a police officer.
Nice. Why do you want to be a police officer?
Putting people in jail, arresting them, and get to drive a police car.
My dream, I'm going to fulfill my mom's dream. She wanted to be a pediatrician, but she ended up being a psychic.
Do you think about where you'll live when you get bigger?
Yes.
So where do you want to live?
Mama's house.
Where do you want to live when you get older?
I already live somewhere.
Where do you want to live when you get older?
I want to go somewhere that I like.
Where do you want to live when you grow up?
In Hollywood.
Maybe Myrtle Beach or here in Conway.
How do you want people to remember you?
Nice.
What are some of your dreams?
I don't have dreams. Because I saw a train. I just didn't dream a house.
So all of us have dreams from the time that we're children, right? Unless of course we happen to see a train. And it just throws us off completely. But no matter where it starts, it grows from there. And to the point where when we hit the college campus, our expectations are enormous. And the thing is, as Americans, God has entrusted us with incredible amounts of wealth and resource. I know a lot of people call you poor college students, but the fact is you're not. In the global community, you're among the wealthiest of wealthy. And so you have the ability, I had the ability as a college freshman to chase after whatever I wanted to. Because at the birth of our nation, our forefathers recognized certain inalienable rights granted to us by our Creator. Those being life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. The pursuit of happiness, therein lies the American dream. And each one of us has been afforded the opportunity to make decisions on what we deem will make us happy. So with each decision, we stand at a crossroads. And what we decide will shape our future. Over the next few years of your lives, these are the decisions that you will be making. What will you decide? What did you decide today? And do you believe that the sum of those decisions will actually bring you happiness? Because in the land of opportunity, the pursuit of happiness is actually no guarantee for happiness. So, is the problem that we haven't obtained enough stuff? Or is it possible that there is no amount of stuff that can bring about that desire of happiness? You see, American history is marked by countless individuals who have achieved fame, fortune, possessions, and even legacy, and yet to have found that elusive happiness. Somehow in their pursuit of more, 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 they've actually found less, less, less. So maybe the question we should be asking is not what did you decide, but why did you decide it? Maybe if we can answer the question of why, we can better understand why all of our pursuits of self-preservation and self-promotion end in emptiness and bondage.
When I first came to college, I came to play soccer. I didn't have a major picked out. I didn't really care for one. My main focus was just coming and playing soccer.
Coming from an international background, my family and I were in pursuit of the American dream since we first set foot on this side of the border. When I came to college, I carried the weight of succeeding where my family had failed in all their ambitions.
Coming into college, I knew that I loved people, but I had no idea what I wanted to major in or what kind of classes I wanted to take.
I never had very big career plans for myself, but my one dream my whole life was I knew I wanted to find a girl who'd be my best friend and then to marry her and have kids and raise a family.
Wasn't really sure what exactly I wanted to major in. I even switched from theater to film before I even started classes, but I knew that I wanted to be famous.
When I came to college, I wanted to be a surgical nurse. I had a passion to help people, and the financial security was very appealing to me.
Growing up, I dreamed of being a wife and a mom, and coming into college, I chose to do occupational therapy in order that I might be able to fulfill that dream.
My freshman year, I was walking through the library, and I was looking at all the authors' names on the books, and I was thinking, man, all these people are dead, but what they have to say, the words that they've written, they're still living on, and I wanted that.
Second semester of my freshman year, I declared a biology major with an emphasis in pre-med, with every intention of becoming a doctor when I graduated.
I had huge dreams of studying biological physics and eventually trying to find a cure for cancer.
I really just wanted to study to be an English teacher. Growing up, my favorite books were adventure books, and I wanted to teach students that if they had a really good book, they could go anywhere, do anything, make a dream again.
Before I even started school, God had already just completely wrecked my life, and I knew that I wanted to serve Him with all that I was. But I had no idea what major to pick, didn't have any idea what I was going to do.
I came to college not really knowing what I wanted to study, and I would go to parties on the weekend looking for friendship and community, but I never really found a sense of belonging there.
I spent the first 3 years of college just in one bad relationship after another, trying to find whoever I was supposed to be with, but I kept ending up with people who were just as selfish as I was.
As I started my classes for occupational therapy, I really struggled to feel adequate enough and smart enough in comparison to the people in my classes.
And I'm listening to my professors talk about how to write and how to publish a book. And I see their lives and I think, this is how my life will be if I keep pursuing this. And their lives are so empty.
I realized that I can teach students to appreciate and read books, but they're just words on pages and the students aren't actually going to be able to live adventures themselves.
My senior year of soccer, I got hurt my second day of practice and I didn't have any backup plans. There was nothing else I had going. I didn't know what I was going to do.
But my freshman year, I failed physics and was left with nowhere to go.
The more that I pursued fame and even any small taste that I had of it, it was completely unsatisfying.
I felt really disconnected and I didn't know what I wanted to do. By the time I graduated college, I'd changed my major 7 times.
The closer I got to achieving my dream of being a doctor, the less and less purpose I felt in it.
And I realized that all the things that I thought would bring success, security, and fulfillment in my life just somehow fell short.
So as I chased after my dream, being an engineer and having the comfortable life, I got involved in Kyle at the University of Nebraska. And I was faced with a consistent tension that I'm going to put before you today. The question of, can the American dream coexist with the kingdom of God? And I want you to hear the words of Scripture as James speaks in James chapter 5, starting in verse 1, and it says, "Now listen, you rich people." And we have to realize that that's talking about us. We cannot escape those words. "Now listen, you rich people, weep and wail because of the misery that is coming upon you. Your wealth has rotted and moths have eaten your clothes. Your gold and silver are corroded. Their corrosion will testify against you and eat your flesh like fire. You have hoarded wealth in the last days." And again, in 2 Timothy, as Paul speaks to young Timothy and says, "But mark this, there will be terrible times in the last days. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, without love, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not lovers of good, treacherous, rash, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. Have nothing to do with these people. They have the form of godliness, but denying its power." You see, every one of us faces divergent paths in our lives. And it's really a consistent thing. There's a dichotomy that exists that I think is really kind of fascinating. That there's this path over here, and at the beginning of it, it looks like freedom. It looks like pleasure. It looks like everything you would ever want. But somehow, at the end of that path, there's just brokenness and emptiness and bondage. And then there's this other path that at the beginning of it, it looks like sacrifice. It looks like death. It feels like you're giving up everything because actually, in fact, you are. But somehow, at the end of that path is the greatest freedom you could ever know. It's the greatest hope and purpose that you could ever experience. And so halfway through my junior year in college, with nothing standing in my way, I mean, I was a straight A student, I had the ability to do it. Nothing standing in my way from being an engineer except for the cross. I made a decision and I chose poverty. I decided to be a campus missionary. And I really believed that would be my reality. I believed that I would be poor for the rest of my life. Would never have the car or the house, the possessions, maybe never even get the wife. Thank God my reality was different than my expectations. And the thing is, I was fine with that. If that would have been my reality, I would have been fine because really, I'd recognized that all I really needed was God. But I found Scripture to be true in Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, when it says, "If you will seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, then all of these things will be added to you as well. And so as I turned and stopped chasing after these things and started chasing after God with everything that I had, living a life of self-sacrifice, I turned around and I saw all these things were actually chasing me. And do you know that I've experienced consistent and miraculous provision throughout my life? That God has brought companionship alongside of me in the form of my wife, who was going in the same direction that I was, and we got married. It was awesome. And we've been being fruitful and multiplying. We've been obeying Scripture. You know, that's the command that we've gotten right from the beginning. You know, we've messed up a lot of things, but be fruitful and multiply. We were like, yeah, we got that. You know, that I've experienced greater purpose in my life than I would ever experience being an engineer. God has entrusted me with dreams. Not my dreams, not the American dream, but with His dreams. And I want you to know that God has a dream for America, but it requires us to change our perspective from a place of self-service and self-promotion to a place of self-sacrifice. For the word says, whoever would save his life will actually lose it. But whoever would lose his life for my sake will find it. And I found those words to be true. And I know that you will as well. As I look through my own heart, and even now as I survey the campus that God has called me to at the University of Central Arkansas, I see the destruction that is laying behind the American dream. And it reminds me of Ezekiel chapter 37, where it says the prophet went to a valley that was filled with very dry bones. Do you know the story? And the word of God comes to him and says, Son of man, can these bones live? He responds back, Sovereign God, you, the one who's in control of everything, you alone know. It says, prophesy to these bones that they might live. And he begins to prophesy. He calls to the four winds, and there's a rattling sound that he starts to hear. And there's hope that he begins to have that this dry valley of dry bones might be more than that. And God called me to a valley of dry bones, the university campus. And so I went and did a CMIT program out in Bozeman, Montana, the most life-changing year of my life. And as a young campus pastor, in 2005, I attended the World Mission Summit. And after eating meals with missionaries and hearing about what was going on in Africa, and being like so intrigued and stirred about the unreached people groups and how these people had never heard about Jesus and this testimony of what was happening, I was like, I want to go. And as I went to these large gatherings and heard testimonies, what's going on in Eurasia, in the Arab world, what's going on in Latin America and all over, do you know that every single missionary that stood up, I was like, man, God, I want to go there. I mean, I don't know what you guys' experience has been, but for me, that's what it was like. It's like every single one, I'm like, yeah, I'm in. How many of me can I send? And I came and I sat in a room really similar to this, in a seat really similar to your seat. And I said before God, God, I do not want Chi Alpha to be my excuse out of missions. I want to be a part of your global plan to take the gospel, this message of self-sacrifice, to the very ends of the earth. And so I will leave behind Chi Alpha. I will pick up my family and I will go anywhere you call me to go. And I distinctly heard the word of the Lord say to me, I've called you, Matt, to the most strategic mission field on the planet, the university campus. And if you will prophesy to that valley of dry bones, I will raise up an army that will go to way more places than you could ever go on your own. And I took that charge, and I said, Sovereign God, you alone know, but I will go and I will prophesy. And you know that at that point, I saw something with my spiritual eyes of an army being raised up out of the University of Central Arkansas, where God has called me to be a campus pastor. And I saw it with my spiritual eyes. And as the years have went on, do you know that I've gotten to begin to see that with my physical eyes? Because God has an American dream. That the valleys of dry bones that fill our college campuses, that is left in the wake of the American dream, might be raised up into an army. But there has to be somebody that will go and that will prophesy to the bones, that will call out to the Spirit of God and say, God, would you fill these bones with life and raise them up to be an army? Where would you be if it wasn't for somebody prophesying to you? Where would you be if somebody didn't see the value in university students and invest their lives into Chi Alpha? I'm going to challenge you to give a year of your life and pray about a lifetime into campus missions. That God might raise up an army out of a valley of dry bones.
So I got involved in Chi Alpha as a freshman, and that's when I started to realize that God had such a bigger dream than any book that I've ever read.
Through my involvement in Chi Alpha, God really was able to teach me that any of the ambitions and dreams that I had in my own life were just a shadow of the dreams He had for me.
I was able to learn the depths of God's love for me and how passionate He is for other people to know that as well.
God really started to speak to me a new identity, that I wasn't just a soccer player, but I was really a son of God. And that right there changed my life forever.
God really spoke to me one day, and He was like, what's worth more, your name on these pages, or is it you turning to the girls behind you and saying, come follow me as I follow after God, and then them turning to the girls behind them and saying, come follow me as I follow after God. And that really goes on into eternity.
I felt God begin to break my heart for those around me, teaching me that there's more to life than fulfilling my selfish desires.
So I began to pray about doing the internship and seeking a life in ministry. And as soon as I decided to consider it, things just started falling into line.
I'd had a dream since I was a little girl to be a missionary. So I knew that giving a year to the Chi Alpha internship was the first step in walking towards that.
He spoke to me that he wanted me to do the internship with Chi Alpha.
From that point on, once I finally figured out that I was supposed to do this internship, really there was nothing else that appealed to me whatsoever.
As I realized how much of an impact campus ministry had on my life, and I wanted to reach students that were just like me.
This was the ministry that taught me so much about God. Why wouldn't I give back a year?
Now I'm giving a year with the Chi Alpha internship.
I'm giving a year and really praying about a lifetime.
I'm giving a year as a Chi Alpha intern.
I'm giving a year to campus ministry.
Estoy dando un año.
I'm giving a year.
I'm giving a year and I'm loving it.
I'm giving a year.
I'm giving a year.
I'm giving a year and I'm praying about a lifetime.
Instead of getting to teach students about the dreams that they can find in books, I get to teach them about the dreams that God has for them instead.
There are so many students out there that really haven't heard the gospel or haven't seen it lived out correctly.
And I get to be a part of them encountering God and God completely turning their lives upside down.
So far to me, this internship has changed my life entirely.
I get to learn so much about God and He's transforming so many things in my life, and then I get to be a part of Him using that to change the students around me.
I've seen the very passion and purpose that God has instilled in my life be carried over into the lives of the very men that I'm discipling here on campus.
Being an intern allows you to see God move in you and the people around you on a daily basis.
It's giving Him everything and allowing Him to do whatever He wants to with your life.
It's definitely one of the best things I've ever done.
If you're considering doing ministry of any kind, I really recommend giving a year to the CMIT program. You get to work under people that have been doing it for years, and you can take what you learn that year and you can apply it anywhere in the world.
It has been the most exciting, most rewarding, most challenging thing I've ever done in my life. I don't see why you wouldn't do it.
It's exciting. You'll learn a heck of a lot about God.
It's something that opens your eyes to new growth and stretches you.
So count the cost, but do it.
It is absolutely worth every single moment of it to be challenged and to be corrected in love.
You'll see God exceed every expectation that you've ever had.
What are you waiting for? There's an adventure out there with your name on it, so come on, let's do this.
So seriously, what about you? Those of us that you've seen before you are just a small picture of what God wants to do on and through the campus. There are hundreds of thousands of students that have fallen asleep spiritually, and each and every one of you have the same call in your lives to awaken the next generation, to call out to the sleepers. Imagine if you gave a year to campus ministry and prayed about a lifetime. God has a dream for America. Are you willing to be a part of it?
So God's blessed me with four biological children, all boys. One of them happens to be want to be a penguin trainer. Because they're cute. And another one wants to be a ninja, evidently. He had told me that in advance. But also, God's blessed me with spiritual children that you see in front of me. Because I've been prophesying to dry bones. God's raising up an army. These are 13 interns at the University of Central Arkansas that God is raising up into an army. And there are internship programs dotted all throughout the United States that are the most incredible training ground for ministry that you could experience. Will you give a year of your life? And actually, the truth is, will you just give your life? When I committed myself to campus ministry, I did a CMIT program. It was decided. I mean, if it helps you to give a year and pray about a lifetime, do that. But really, we just want your life. Because that's what's going to take. Yeah, I'm going to read these words and leave you with this. It's out of 1 Timothy chapter 6, but I'm going to read this to you in first person. I command you, who are rich in this present world, not to be arrogant, nor to put your hope in wealth, which is so uncertain, but to put your hope in God, who richly provides you with everything for your enjoyment. I command you to do good and to be rich in good deeds, and to be generous and willing to share. In this way, you will lay up for yourselves treasures as a firm foundation for the coming age, so that you might take hold of the life that is truly life. Will you abandon the American dream and exchange it for God's dreams for America? Will you give a year and pray about a lifetime into campus missions? Let's pray. Father God, I ask that you allow your word to settle on our hearts, God. And that we would not just be hearers of your word, but we would be doers also. I pray that you stir us to a place of action, not just a place of emotion. God, give us the courage to respond to you, to lay down everything. Not to put our hope in the things of this world, which is so uncertain, but to put our hope in you, to trust that you are the only thing that we need. Pray that you allow your call to be heard and help us to have the courage to respond. In Jesus' name. If you agree with that, say amen.
Amen.
Thank you all so much for your time and attention today. As Matt said, there are dozens of campuses in America where you can go and spend a year serving under an established and fruitful missionary in an intensive and structured campus missionary training program. If you would like more information on one of these internships, or you'd like more information on serving for a year on your local ministry staff team, as you exit the doors, there will be some people on your right that will take your information. We'll use that information to get in touch with you after the conference with more information on how you can get in touch with one of these programs. You guys have heard the need. You've heard the need. Every one of you is here in this room because someone else thought it was worth giving their lives to invest in university students. So please seriously consider giving a year back into campus missions. Please watch for small children as you leave, and don't disturb the elephants. Enjoy the rest of your day.